Thank you very much for your kind introduction. So the topic I will cover today is about the COVID-19, the symptomatic and treatment. I would show you the case, the real case that admitted in our hospital, and we will raise some questions, some interesting point, and we will show you the data to support what we have to manage in that situation. So this case is a 70-year-old Thai man at the on the February the 2nd. This is the first field the local transmission case in Thailand. This patient presented with a symptom of a deterioration of consciousness and a general weakness. At that moment, oxygen saturation at ambient air was only 80%. He has a poor air lung entry, he has confusion and moderate grade 3 at all extremity. The presumed diagnosis at that moment is acute stroke and a respiratory failure. So he was rescued by the endotracheal tube intubation at the emergency room, and he was transferred to the intensive care unit. Later on, his relative report, he has a history of contact with a Chinese group tour between 22nd to 28th of January. Vital sign, the body temperature was 37, the pulse pressure is 110, blood pressure is quite high, respiratory rate is 20 per minute. The lungs quite clear, the CBC showed high, the white blood cells 10,000 and over 10,000 and platelets normal. He has a band form, you can see he has a band form, it's a left shift, it's 24%. The kidney function is quite normal, electrolyte is quite normal. He has a elevated of the transaminase enzyme. The arterial blood gas during on the PCV mode at and the FiO2 80%, PS is 7.485, PCO2 is 26 and PO2 is 133. The rapid test for influenza and the sputum smear for tuberculosis was negative. This is the exchange X-ray on the first day of admission. So you can see here that he has a bilateral interstitial infiltration and predominate at both the lower lung field. But you can observe the right upper infiltration also when compared to the left. It's quite more on the right upper lung field. And we check the PCR for the SARS-CoV-2. The results show the detected the SARS-CoV-2. My first question is, what is the uncommon presentation and the extra pulmonary complication of the patient with COVID-19? I think you all know well about the typical representation of the COVID-19 patients. As I show you in this case, the patient present this elderly patient. This patient presented with confusion, with alteration of consciousness. So the presumed diagnosis at the emergency room was acute stroke, not COVID-19. So this is the point that what is the uncommon presentation and subsequent extra pulmonary complication or manifestation in the patients with COVID-19. So let me show you the classical, the clinical syndromes of the COVID-19 first. So as you know that most of the patients, about 60 to 70% present with the mild illness, such as only a mild fever or running nose or myalgia. And the second syndrome is a moderate illness. There's a clinical signs of pneumonia, like a fever, cough, shortness of breath, but not severe. The sat oxygen, saturation of oxygen is quite normal or above 90% on the ambient air. The third one is a severe pneumonitis. The clinical syndrome is compatible with the pneumonia plus the following condition: respiratory rate above 30 per minute, severe respiratory distress or saturation oxygen is less than 93% on the room air. And the last clinical syndrome is ARDS. As you know, it's classified as mild, moderate, and severe ARDS. It depends on the PF ratio. It's less than 300, 200, and 100 respectively. This is the 200 patients, COVID-19 patients, who admitted in our hospital. I show you the symptom that they present in at the first few days on the admission. About 60% of the patients diagnosed with the mild disease. About 20% of the patients diagnosed with the moderate COVID disease. And about 13% diagnosed with the severe COVID-19 disease. And the less proportion is about 5 to 6% present with the respiratory failure or ARDS. This is compatible with the international cohort or data that report from other continents of the world. As I asked you in the first question is, what is it a typical or uncommon presentation of the COVID-19? Some patient might present with the petechiae, there's a bleeding tendency or thrombocytopenia shown in the blood smear. Some of the patient might present with the acute diarrhea. Some paper show that about 3% present with a voluminous watery diarrhea at the presentation. And we also have the patient present with the acute diarrhea, and we observe that in case of the patient present with acute diarrhea, most of them do turn to the severe disease. And the next one is a neurological presentations like this case, present with acute confusional state. About 9% of the patients in this cohort present with a confusion, and this patient usually had a severe infection and resulted to death. And last one is some might present with a renal dysfunction, has a decreased urine output, has an uncorrectable metabolic acidosis and electrolyte disturbance. For the major extrapulmonary complications, such as a cardiac injury, it's present within the late complication developed after the patient present with the acute respiratory distress syndrome, such as a cardiomyopathy, pericarditis, pericardial effusion, arrhythmia, myocardial infarction, congestive heart failure, or sudden cardiac arrest. In Thailand, we have one case present with MI or myocardial infarction at the presentation, but finally he developed the lung infiltration and we diagnosed with the COVID-19 after admitted with the chest pain. The second one is acute kidney injury. Some might have the hematuria and we have a proteinuria, especially in the severe COVID-19 cases. And the next one might have the elevated liver enzyme, that the transaminitis. And the next one is the neurologic complications such as the delirium, encephalopathy developed in 2/3 of the patients with ARDS. Some might have the acute ischemic stroke, and the minority might have the encephalitis. And the last one is some patients develop the coagulopathy, as you have seen in the published article over the past few months. And what is the risk factor for the COVID-19 patients? As a WHO guideline in May 2020, they classify risk as two categories. The first one is determined by age. If the patient have age more than 60 years old, and the second one is classified by the underlying disease, especially underlying non-communicable disease, include hypertension, cardiac disease, chronic lung disease, cerebral vascular disease, diabetes, or any immunocompromised conditions, such as a cancer patient who received an immunosuppressive or drug, and also the chronic active smoking. I show you the data of the age on the left side. You see here the age from the 10 year up to 80 years. And the right hand side, you see the death rate according to the age range. If the patient have age 10 to 19 years old, the death rate is only 0.2%. But the age, the death rate is up to 3.6% if the patient have are older than 60 years old, and up to 50% if the patient is above 80 years old. And on the right hand side is the table of the death rate related to the comorbidity. You can see here the cardiovascular disease, diabetes, chronic lung disease, hypertension, cancer is also related to the higher the mortality rate, from 5 to 6% up to 10% in the patient with the cardiovascular disease. My next question: this is the result of the RP33 or the real-time PCR of the RESMI pathogen panel. The result showed negative for all the pathogens in the RP33 test. My next question is, what potential antiviral replicating agents would you comment in this case? And any consideration in the elderly patient with COVID-19? So this picture showed the COVID, SARS-CoV-2 life cycle and the drug target. As you can see here, this is the SARS-CoV-2, and this is the target cell, you know, like alveolar cell, alveolar cell type 2. And the virus attack use the spike protein on the membrane, use the S1 subunit attached to the ACE2 receptor, and also use the TMPRSS2 or transmembrane serine protease on the membranes of the host cell to cleavage the ACE2 receptor and accelerate the virus particle into the host cell. And you can see this is the potential the drug target, such as the inhibitor TMPRSS2 at the cell membrane, like a car, such as the chymostat mesylate. And the next one is the arbidol or the chloroquine or hydroxychloroquine that increase the endosomal the pH, or this just act like alkalinize the pH in the endosome. This is a HIV protease inhibitor, as you know about the lopinavir or the lunavir that inhibit the proteolysis process. And the most promising data is right here about the RDRP dependent RNA inhibitor. This is remdesivir and the favipiravir. I will show you the clinical data later. And also in case of the severe COVID-19, you know about the cytokine storm. So some agent might have the benefit to block the cytokine storm, such as interleukin-6, interleukin-1 blocking agent. I will mention about the cytokine storm management in the subsequent presentation. This is the in vitro data of the EC50 of the favipiravir, chloroquine, and remdesivir. As you can see here, this is the EC50 for the favipiravir on the left upper corner. Right here on the right side is the chloroquine and the remdesivir. It's the most promising, the EC50. You can see here on the red line is the remdesivir, and the high potency in the in vitro data. In the clinical data, what is the outcome? So you can see here, this is from the Dr. John Beagle from the USA. This published this data in the New England Journal of Medicine a few weeks ago. This is a double-blind randomized controlled trial of the intravenous remdesivir. The doses of the remdesivir used in the trial is 200 milligram on the first day and 100 milligram on the second day to the 10th day. In the adult hospitalized COVID-19 patients with evidence of a lower respiratory tract infection. And the primary outcome of the study is time to recovery. What is time to recovery? They defined the time to recovery is either discharge from hospital or hospitalization for IC purposes only. So there is no indication to treat the COVID-19 anymore. So we classify as a time to recovery. So you can see on the left side, this is the overall the patients. The red line is placebo and the blue line is the remdesivir. And you can see the proportion to receive the time to recovery or the primary outcome of the study. You can see the remdesivir, the patient who received remdesivir had the time to recovery of 11 days. Compared to the placebo is 15 days. The p-value is less than 0.001. And sub-analysis of the patient who did not receive the oxygen supplement and also the patient who did receive the oxygen supplement, the data show exactly the same with overall data on the left-hand side. But the blue lines, the remdesivir had a higher higher chance to receive the primary outcome of the study compared to the placebo. And another study of the remdesivir is this data is from the compassionate use of remdesivir for the 33 patients who confirmed SARS-CoV-2 infection who had oxygen saturation of less than 94%. On ambient air or who need to receive oxygen supplement. And they receive the 10-day course of the remdesivir. And the dose they use is 200 milligrams on the first day, followed by the 100 milligrams on subsequent 9 days. On the right side is a baseline demographic and clinical characteristics of the patients of this subgroup to invasive. Receive the invasive ventilation and non-invasive oxygen support. On the left side is the result of the study. This is the overall. So you can see that about 70% of the patients receive the clinical improvement. This is the day after 28 days of the. After the 28th day of the initiation of the remdesivir, this is on the x-axis represent the cumulative incidence of the clinical improvement. And on the right side is separate the divide the patient into two groups. The first group is a non-invasive sub-oxygen supplement, and the second group is an invasive oxygen supplement. As you can see that the patient who received non-invasive oxygen supplement have higher chance to receive the clinical the improvement that defined in the study compared to the patient who receive invasive oxygen supplement. It's quite straightforward that the patient more severe have a higher chance to get the improvement from the treatment. The second medicine, the antiviral drug that we might use quite a lot in Thailand is the favipiravir. The action of the favipiravir is quite the same with the remdesivir that inhibit the RNA synthesis of the virus at this process. But it just show you that at the beginning, the favipiravir was approved to treat the neuraminidase inhibitor resistant influenza, not for the SARS-CoV-2, but actually for the influenza virus. This was registered in the Japan's FDA. And you can see this is the data of the susceptible influenza virus and the resistant virus. And you can see that this is susceptible to the favipiravir by the EC50. You can see this is the activity of the favipiravir for the NA inhibitor resistant influenza virus. How about for the COVID-19 patients? This data is a study in the COVID-19 IPD patients. And all of the patients received the classified into two groups. The first group is favipiravir, and the second group received the lopinavir and ritonavir. It's in the dashed line. Dashed line is represent the lopinavir group, and the solid line is the favipiravir group. And both received the combined with the inhaled interferon alpha for 14 days, and they follow up to 14 days, 2 weeks. And you can see that this is a cumulative of the PCR positive. So the patient who received the favipiravir have a higher chance to receive the PCR negative compared to the lopinavir, the 4 days versus 11 days. The p-value is less than 0.001. And on the right side, right-hand side box, is a CT scan of the chest. And you can see in the red box that I highlight down here is a day 14 after treatment. The improvement in the favipiravir group is 91% compared to the lopinavir is only 62%. P-value is 0.004. I show you the update, the Thai clinical practice guideline that's published from the Thai Ministry of Public Health, collaborate with the Medical Society, Infectious Disease Society of Thailand, and Royal College of Medicine of Thailand. They classify into two groups based on the clinical symptom. From the left, far left is a no symptom until to the pneumonia. So in case of the patient present with the pneumonia, we suggest to treat 5 to 10 days with the favipiravir plus chloroquine or hydroxychloroquine plus darunavir and lopinavir. But in the next version, in the future version, we might remove some of the medicine like chloroquine or hydroxychloroquine from the CPG. Back to our case. This case, as I showed you at the beginning of my presentation, that the patient has also had the right upper lung infiltration. So this is the reason why the attending physicians wonder about the co-infection of the tuberculosis, because this one is common in Thailand. So we check with the gene expert, and it showed that the gene expert of the MTB showed detected, but the rifampicin-resistant is not detected in the second test. So my next question is, how would you modify antiviral and anti-TB treatment in co-infected COVID-19 and TB patients? So you have to know that potential anti-COVID-19 medicine and anti-TB drug has some drug-drug interaction. There's some drug-drug interaction, as I show you in this slide. On the left side is the anti-COVID-19 medicine, and on the right side is the first-line anti-TB, and on the far right column is the second-line anti-TB drug. I highlight on the red box is the rifampicin is one of the most concern for about the drug-drug interaction between the TB treatment and COVID-19 treatment. And you can see that remdesivir that we might use a lot for the COVID-19 patients have a drug-drug interaction with the rifampicin. Rifampicin might decrease the blood level of remdesivir. So this is one of the major concern or consideration when you have to treat co-infected COVID-19 and TB patients. So I suggest you, in case of the patient have to receive the many the medication like have the polypharmacy, I suggest you to use the two drug interaction tool, like to use from the University of Liverpool. You can check medicine that the patient receive and it come up with, and show you the possible the drug interaction or significant drug interaction you need to concern or you need to modify in your patients. So what we manage in this case, so we start as I show you that the patient have the left shift of the blood, the CBC have the band form very high, the proportion of the band form. So we empiric with the antibiotic with the piperacillin tazobactam, and we start the anti-tuberculosis drug with the first line TB treatment in Thailand, isoniazid, rifampicin, ethambutol plus the pyrazinamide. But eventually, as I told you, that the patient have to treat the COVID-19 with the protease beta. So we switch rifampicin to quinolone. So we switch to levofloxacin for the first 10 days. And after we switch the ritonavir, we discontinue the ritonavir. So we switch levofloxacin back to rifampicin. So for the anti-COVID-19 treatment, we start with the ritonavir, ritonavir, plus chloroquine, 500 milligrams twice a day, and plus the favipiravir, 1,600 milligrams twice a day on day one, then step down to 600 milligrams twice a day. This is the first case in Thailand that received the favipiravir, because we have got favipiravir around the end of the February. And the hemoglobin A1C of this case is 8.9%. So this is the first time of diagnosis of the diabetes in this case. So my next question is, what is your consideration in COVID-19 patients with diabetes? So not only the TB, but he also had underlying disease of the diabetes also. So on this slide, I show you the data, the systematic review and meta-analysis of the diabetes as in the patient of COVID-19 with diabetes. And this is a forest plot. And you can see on the diamond shape down here that the patient called the COVID-19 patient who had diabetes had a higher chance to develop the severe clinical outcome in this systematic review. And how about the mortality rate? It's also pretty much the same with the severe clinical outcome. It showed that the patient with the COVID-19 who diagnosed with diabetes had a higher chance to higher mortality rate than the patient without diabetes. And what is the proposed mechanism to contribute to increase the severe condition in the patient with the diabetes? I start with the SARS-CoV-2 virus. SARS-CoV-2 enter into the respiratory tract and infected into the alveolar cell type 2 as normal, the pathway of the virus. In diabetes patient, what happened more than the normal condition? The diabetes patient have the higher chance to impair neutrophil recruitment. The second one is the diabetes patient have a higher chance to impair interferon alpha production from the NK cell. The third one is higher chance to impair antigen presenting cell, and also has a high chance to dysregulate immune response, and might have increased ACE2 expression by disease itself or by the medicine that some propose about the hypertension, drug or other that increase the ACE2 expression in the body. So it's all these five the proposed mechanism have related to contribute to increase the severity in the COVID-19 patients with the diabetes. And The next consideration is the drug-drug interaction between COVID-19 drugs and anti-diabetes drug. Not only the TB drug, as I showed you earlier. On the left side is the anti-diabetic drug, such as acarbose, dapagliflozin, gribenchamide, glycoside, glipizide, insulin, or vidagliptin down here. And on the right side is lopinavir, favipiravir, or chloroquine that's used in for the COVID-19 patient in Thailand. So you can see that they have some drug-drug interaction, especially HIV protease inhibitor or lopinavir. You can see the orange color or the red on the yellow color that represent the, some the drug-drug interaction. And also favipiravir have a increased but level of leprechaunide that have a higher chance to develop hypoglycemia in the patient who received both drug together. Back to our patients. This is a subsequent chest X-ray on the February the 4th and the February the 7th. You can see the patient have the progression of the bilateral infiltration at the both the lower lung fields. So my next question is, what is the clinical course of the severe COVID-19?